Thank you. So I did put first some of the slides from yesterday just to remind. You remember we wanted to classify regular inclusions, regular subalgebras of the hyperfinite one, but in the sense of inclusions, so the isomorphism class of this. So that's what we want to classify. We impose this condition always. It's really very natural. So this is something you'll always assume for such this type of problem, this relative commutant condition. Okay, the relative commutant of the subalgebra should be included in B, meaning that it's equal to the center. So we've already done it, right, of course, for the case B abelian, where regularity, this condition amounts to B being a massa, and a regular massa is what we call the Cartan subalgebra. We did that, that's Kohn-Feldman-Weiss. The next, of course, case of interest is when B is a subfactor, and then this condition amounts to B, which when it is a one factor, I generically call it N. When N has trivial relative commutant in R. And I said that then, the normalizer divided by the unitary group of N, that will be a countable group, it's very easy to see, and amenability of the ambient algebra of M translates into this, implies that this group is amenable. Also, this normalizer really, this situation, the regular inclusion, the fact that the inclusion is regular amounts to this, the algebra. You remember this was from one of the previous pages, actually we'll get back to that. It amounts, so if N is a subfactor which has trivial relative commutant in another factor, this doesn't depend, of course, on the ambient factor being R, with trivial relative commutant and regular, so as I said, you have this normalizing group, and in fact, M will be a cocycle cross product with this group, okay? So this is a general fact, and it's very easy, it's an observation. And so for regular subfactors, the answer is given by Ognanus' theorem. So irreducible inclusions are completely classified by that into R, irreducible regular inclusions. So subfactors, trivial relative commutant, and regular are completely classified by their normalizing group. So this group that I said before, the normalizing group, of course, it is an invariant, but it's a complete invariant. In other words, if N0 is another such subfactor, then the two are conjugate by an automorphism of the ambient factor R, if and only if these groups, the corresponding normalizing groups, are isomorphic. Of course, you can also view it this way. Since you always have for a group gamma the Bernoulli action, this amounts to saying that any kind of inclusion like this with gamma normalizing group is isomorphic to this special inclusion, which we view like a model inclusion, which is this, N into N cross product gamma, where N is the hyperfinite one factor in this representation, and the action of gamma is the Bernoulli action. Okay, so this is kind of nice to emphasize it this way. So all this brought into attention this situation with this normalizing group. which gives rise to a co-cycle action, in fact, on N. So we started the whole discussion about arbitrary co-cycle actions. I reminded you what a co-cycle action is, free co-cycle actions. Then I emphasized these two. You will see why. Okay, so I meant to put, though already last time, to put up this, to give these two examples of co-cycles that, you know, are not at all obvious that they could be untwisted, that they are, well, I guess here is not yet the definition of what we mean by vanishing of the the untwisting or such a co-cycle being co-boundary, but we'll see that soon. I just gave immediately two examples of co-cycles and co-cycle actions, more precisely. This the so-called Kohn-Jones co-cycle and these amplified co-cycles. So they, just to show you that they come up naturally in you know, lots of situations. And I emphasized also that co-cycle actions, you can construct for a co-cycle action the cross product for Neumann algebra exactly the same way we did it for genuine actions. I remind you that when the action is, so this we did, you know, and also on the previous page for arbitrary, for co-cycle actions on arbitrary threshold for Neumann algebras, but let me remind you that when you act on a 2-1 factor, the freeness, well, in general, freeness amounts to this condition, B prime intersected M is the center of B, and in the case of when acting on a 2-1 factor, that amounts to the to N being irreducible, having trivial relative commutant in the cross product. So in other words, when you have a co-cycle action on a 2-1 factor, you have that gives rise to a cross product algebra with the subfactor N naturally sitting in it, okay, and it's regular in it, obviously. And here I emphasize that you have conversely, when you have an irreducible regular subalgebra, regular inclusion of factors, then, you know, this normalizing group actually implements, if you denote it by gamma, it implements an action on a co-cycle action on N, and you can view this inclusion as N into N cross product with this co-cycle action with gamma, I mean identifying M in that manner as a cross product algebra. Okay, so you see this is, how this correspondence, so it shows you that you have like a complete equivalence. Of course, in fact, I think I mentioned that on the next page. Yes. Yes, exactly. So here I mentioned that two co-cycle actions. So first of all, what it means for them to be co-cycle conjugate. I guess here I wanted to correct Masaki pointed out that I have to add of WG, I forgot the WG, sorry. Okay, so it's an add of the WG here. Okay, so these two axioms, so the there exists an isomorphism of the ground spaces that intertwines the action modulo, some inner perturbation of one of them, and with the co-cycles, you know, going from one to another in this way. And this is the point I wanted to make. So two free cocycle actions on two-one factors are cocycle conjugate in this sense, if and only if the corresponding inclusions are isomorphic. Okay? So you have these two categories basically with corresponding isomorphism between objects which are kind of equivalent, okay? The cocycle actions and respectively inclusions, the associated inclusions. Okay. So the untwisting means that, or two cocycle means this, that you can find a one variable unitary valued function on gamma such that the VGH is the delta, I mean the derivative sort of, yeah, the co-boundary of this WG. So I emphasize that this is more, right? It's a stronger condition than just the fact that this is becomes a genuine action. It says this, but it says more. So it is this thing, which is more than, you know, just saying that this becomes a genuine action. If you look in the cross product thing, you know, it really is equivalent this to saying that you have a perturbation of the canonical unitaries which give you a representation of the group, a gamma representation, actually a copy of the left regular. Okay. And give you an example. I wanted to put this up very quickly because, you see, this is a non-amenable group that, you know, has no cohomology yet whatsoever. So we'll see because, you know, this is to keep in mind all the time because we'll talk about untwisting cocycles for amenable groups. It may make you think that, you know, it's specific for amenable groups, this untwisting of two cocycles. Well, it's not, okay? So the groups... there is one very non-amenable group for which you have no two cocycles in some sense, right? Okay. I think we were more or less here. Okay, so I'm sorry I lost this 15 minutes, but we needed to recall a little bit the context. So I stated Ognanov's theorem in that form that gives the classification of regular subalgebras which are factors with that condition, which becomes then irreducibility, subfactors of R. Actually, it's not the original statement of Ognanov. His theorem simply states that any two free cocycle actions of a countable amenable group gamma on R are cocycle conjugate. But we have seen that's equivalent to that formulation, okay, for inclusion. Now, this result was already known, so this is the way things happened historically. It was Kohn who proved it for gamma, for automorphism. So he classified all automorphisms, periodic or aperiodic, of the hyperfinite to one. There is more into this story because there is also an H3 cocycle, which is an invariant. I don't want to get into that. So we just take actions, free actions of groups, in particular in this case of Z, Z over NZ. So that's how, yeah. Okay, and so in that case was Kohn, and that was a very strong motive. I mean, of course, it's great and interesting to classify automorphisms of the hyperfinite one. After all, you know, this is an obvious, you know, sort of dynamics, non-commutative dynamic that is, you know, obviously interesting. So we passed from the unit interval, which is the standard probability measure space in classical dynamics, now to a non-commutative unit interval, which is our hyperfinite one. The first thing you want to look at, you know, I mean, one of the first things is to look at its symmetries, its automorphies. And, you know, this was big deal for the probability measure space, you know, ergodic theory, dynamical system, etc. I mean, measurable dynamics. Well, so one would obviously like to see it here, and as it happens, it's an extraordinary problem. Already there is something which we will not touch in these lectures at all, which is that besides your sort of usual notion of symmetry, which I would say that's an automorphism, you have what one could call quantum symmetries, which are endomorphisms of finite index. Well, to make it short, it's the whole Jones theory of subvectors. Okay, so that's what can be viewed as the studying generalized symmetries of the hyperfinite one and more generally of arbitrary one factors. It's an extraordinary rich subject and, you know, very actually complicated and hard and with lots of fantastic things happening. But we don't go into that, at least, I mean, at some point we'll have to comment more on subfactor theory, but, you know, not going too deep into it. Moreover, in fact, Jones proved also that any two free gamma actions on R for a gamma finite are in fact conjugate. Okay, and also Kohn, in fact, proved it for Z over N, that any two periodic automorphies, you know, are actually conjugate. Cocycle conjugacy is same as conjugacy because one cocycles are co-boundary. Okay, so that's actually, you know, it's like saying this. Okay, so that's on the one hand. I also want to emphasize that since, so Ocneanu proved this uniqueness theorem, right? So any two cocycle actions are cocycle conjugate. Now any group has an actual action on R, which is by Bernoulli shifts, right? So since you take now any other cocycle gamma action, it will be cocycle conjugate to this germane action. So that means that any cocycle action untwists, any two cocycle untwists, right? Because it's cocycle conjugate to an actual action, right? You remember the definition and we emphasize this fact, okay? So his result also says that any cocycle, any two cocycle of a cocycle action untwists, is co-boundary. Let's keep that in mind. Just getting back to the initial formulation, since gamma is amenable, the cross product of R with, I'm getting back of why this implies the other, okay? I mean, just pointing out that, of course, you use Kohn's theorem, because you get that the ambient, the cross product factor is isomorphic to R, so you are dealing with subfactors of R here. Ogneanu shows that any such irreducible regular inclusion N into R is a true untwisted cross product, okay, coming from a genuine gamma action. I put it also at the end of the formulation of first page of this. Okay, so I was thinking to give a sketch of the proof of Ocneanu's theorem. So there are, so the proof he gave is, you know, quite involved because it really goes the hard way. What happens, I can explain you a little bit of two things that were, you know, very important. One was the Ornstein-Weiss theorem that we talked about with the actions on the probability measure space and of amenable groups being orbit equivalent. Now, their proof is not, what I showed you as a proof was the Kohn-Feldman-Weiss, which is stronger, okay, a theorem. And you remember with the little local finite dimensional approximation, etc. So, however, the Ornstein-Weiss theorem, which appeared a year before Kohn-Feldman-Weiss, so this is how things happen. So Ornstein and Weiss proved that result. And then Feldman and Feldman and Weiss started to think more towards, you know, proving that any equivalence, amenable equivalence, abstract amenable equivalence relation, so not necessarily coming from a free action of an amenable group, also was giving you this unique amenable groupoid amenable equivalence relation. So which amounts, you know, to this uniqueness of the Cartan, but without the cycle vanishing. So they discussed with Kohn, and then together the three of them, you know, proved this. As it happens, the proof is basically what I showed you. So it's identical. That's the proof they gave, you know, with this local approximation. So this is what inspired me to give the proof of Kohn's theorem in those years. But it's really their proof. Okay, Kohn-Feldman-Weiss, what I showed you. The proof was so slick and so quick and elegant and short. And by the way, they did it, you know, for arbitrary, not necessarily 2-1. They did it for types 3, type any, you know, amenable action. That Ornstein-Weiss basically never wrote their entire paper. So the whole thing remained as an announcement, in which, however, they indicate they sketch the proof, and they, in particular, they do this kind of what they call tilings of the amenable of an amenable group, which is pretty important, you know, way of covering the amenable group with Wöllner sets, and that is something very structural result that's very important and has been very useful, in particular in C-star algebra theory recently, you know, in C-star dynamics, so to say, and that is the, you know, thing that Ognanu used a lot, okay? So that is, he proved it first for Z square, by the way, but where these tilings are obvious because, that means amounts to covering the plane with squares. But in general, you know, you needed something similar with that, and he needed with his argument. So I have the other proofs of this result. One which I can, it's very convincing, I think. So here is, so what you, in all these things, you want to prove that given an action, an arbitrary action, or rather a cocycle action of an amenable group, you prove that you sort of built up in it, okay, in your hyperfinite 2-1 modulo perturbation, you are allowed to do perturbation by unitaries, and you built in R like a model, a way you reconstruct R in a manner, for instance, say by miracle, perhaps you can even construct inside copies of 2x2 matrices that mutually commute, and with the group acting on those matrices by Bernoulli shift. That's called a model. So you build, you fix yourself some model that you think you can recover inside R and prove that your action is basically that model action, okay? That's also the strategy that Ornstein used when he proved his famous theorem about two automorphies having the same, two Bernoulli action, Bernoulli automorphies having the same entropy, you know, being a conjugate. And for instance, in the case of Z, you may want to do like this on R. So what you do is the basic tool is here the Rocklin theorem. So you let's say that you look into R cross Z, right? And so I'm trying to use the notations and the intuition we developed for the for the Kohn-Feldman bias, for instance. So given any set of elements, the thing is that I can you can prove that given any set finite in R. So this is, by the way, it's given by you know, things like this, right? So I wanted to emphasize the canonical unitaries. Okay, so for any finite, any epsilon, and let's fix also a natural any n, or rather let's call it k. Okay, I want to prove that there exists a projection Q, sort of infinitesimal in R. So that's the way you have to think, like we always do. So small net projection that avoids F. It's always relative to the size of Q, and which satisfies that, let's call it sigma. Okay, such that sigma g, so this ug, but let's use sigma g. Sigma g of, yes, you will understand why I use this k. Sigma, sorry. Actually, this is z, so this is just one automorphism. So let's call it theta this time. So theta to the n of q are mutually orthogonal. Again, this is approximate. Okay? Theta to the n for n from 0 to k. So in other words, you want to do something like this with your automorphism, okay? All this is arbitrary, so k can be huge, okay? So if this k can be huge, and you can do that, then you can then return with an add of, with an, a partial isometry, so you can perturb your theta with the partial isometry that moves you back, and which, you know, what will it add with respect to the identity? It's like perturbing theta with an add u, okay, such that this u is basically, you know, almost like, I mean, of course it's not one, but the defect is completely controlled by just the size of this incremental thing, right? Incremental thing, with respect to the overall size, so it's of the order, this is over order of 1 over k, or delta times delta of tau of k. Okay? So I'm keeping this, but also that. So, altogether, what you can do with this, and I hope I can, you know, be quite convincing after all we've done, is that, you know, each time I'm giving something like this, I'm doing this infinitesimally. This is not hard, okay? What I've just set up to here is really not hard, okay? Because of the hyperfinite, the definition of hyperfinite-ness and so on. So the what you do though from here is a maximality argument, and you fill up the identity. So for that, it's really kind of useful that you have this neat Fellner sets, you know, for Z. I'm using this, you know, this long sequence 1 up to K, and we're taking K huge, okay? So you see, I want this 1 over K, you know, very small. This, so I fill up the identity, and so I can, with the maximality argument, can then, you know, I'm claiming that there exists, perhaps we should have called this U0. There exists an actual a unitary that now, you know, really does this. I mean, this, this now. These are really mutually orthogonal. Maybe I should say n from n from 0 up to k minus 1. Okay, so the powers now of this new automorphism, this will be mutually orthogonal and filling up the identity. So the sum equals 1. So, okay, I think it's this is okay. And what did I do by doing that? It means that I created a situation where, you know, I have an K by K matrix algebra on which, you know, with a little bit of care, you, this is, implies that this new automorphism leaves a K by K matrix algebra invariant and on which it acts like the permutation. The permutation of, you know, the cyclic permutation of 1, 2, 3 up to K. I mean, out of U where, you know, I'm sorry. So it's like, it acts like add of this unitary. Okay. So now, and then you have the rest. So you split off, you take this matrix algebra, relative commutant in R. And now you continue. Okay, so the thing is playing with this K, so I, this is my defect for this, okay? But I do this with an extremely rapidly increasing K, okay? And I split this way R as a tensor product this way, with now theta, I perturb it with unitaries, with an infinite tensor product of unitaries. But their product will be a unitary in R, because they are 1 over k closed, so 1 over kn closed, and I can make that convergent. So it will be another, let's call it ad capital U. Okay, such that, okay, and which will act on this guy as the following model. My model is the following, is the tensor product of add of little u n, where these are the cyclic. It's the, okay, this is an action of, okay, this is the, this is Kohn's theorem for Z. Now, clearly, you can make this work for Z square, because it's nothing, you know, with, it's just, now I claim that you can do it, and by the way, it gives you an action, a true action, okay? So I, you perturb it in, and you show that it's isomorphic to this action. there are several problems here. You may not, I mean, in the case of Z, you have no cocycle. At Z squared, you have a cocycle. So how do you deal with that? Well, you see, there is this thing that all this you can do in the commutant, okay, of stuff. And that's what you do if you have a cocycle. You avoid the cocycle. You only... right, so it becomes a little bit technical, but, you know, it's not such a big deal. In the case of Z squared, already you have to deal with that, okay? Because you may have a cocycle, okay? Well, what do you do for arbitrary gamma with this strategy? So the way I you can do it exactly the same way is you prove, rather than proving that, you know, to untwist it and all that, you know, the way, for instance, O'Connor did, you prove that your action is cocycle. So you construct a model cocycle action, okay, which is somewhat unusual. And your cocycle action is this. You construct a huge Ferner sets, I mean, more and more invariant sets, Kn, and your model will be this. So it's in Kn by Kn, I mean cardinality here, but matrix algebra, okay? So these are almost invariant to, say your group is finitely generated. Okay, gamma. So these are more and more invariant to your generators. And then I do exactly the same thing. So this is this matrix algebra. So the Ferner set, they are more and more invariant to gamma. So gamma will displace a bit this matrix algebra. And I bring it back. So, and every time I it's like, having a permutation of your Kn, that a finite permutation which imitates gamma, right? But which I fix once for all. So you see, it's they are really indexed my matrices by Kn as a set, and so Kn is displaced. So this is a set. The set Kn is displaced by the elements in the group, I mean the generators of the group, and so I have to decide where these things go, and I put them once for all to go, and I make some prescribed choice, but which will be it for, you know, that will be my model. So I have some chosen permutation, in other words, of the sets Kn, okay, which imitate my group. I do that, okay, and I take this again, the infinite tensor product, and with the same technique, you build this model cocycle action, because it will no longer, you have some perturbations here. But if you do this with huge, this is extremely, extremely invariant. You know, it means that what goes out, which every time what goes out, you will have to use a perturbation by a unitary to put it back. And that unitary will be close to one with this kind of, level of accuracy. Right? With this level of accuracy. So if this, I can make it extremely fast, going to zero, then the product of those unitaries will be a unitary. But it's a perturbation. So it will add, even if you started with an action, it becomes a cocycle action this way. But it's your model. This is your model. Okay? There is another proof that you can give through subfactor theory, but let's not get to that. At least not for that. Prof? Okay. So, yeah, I wanted to at least, you know, wave my hands and try to be in a convincing manner, you know. Anyway, this the proof I told you is actually, you can find it in a paper of mine in Yasu's journal. What's the name of that? International, math journal, I think. Okay. The second approach is through subfactor theory. I'll explain that because it's not here at the moment. So let's move on. Okay, so now we have the case abelian, right? And the case factorial. So in general, when you have a regular subalgebra in a 2-1 factor with this condition, and say I denote by L infinity of x the center, you know, I write it as the L infinity of sub probability measure space with the mu given by the restriction of the trace on M that you restrict here. Of course, the assumptions imply that B is homogeneous. And that says what? That either it is B will be of this form, so it is of type 1n, okay, right? Or it will be like this. It will be an integral, okay, of 2-1 factors. Okay, that's why, you know, pretty, I mean, it's, I think it's, it requires, you know, this, what do you call this, well, you can write it as a measurable field of 2-1 factors, like an integral of 2-1 factors. You know, this is all von Neumann, Mare von Neumann. Actually, it's just von Neumann who, you know, did this first. So now, if in addition M is the hyperfinite to 1, you can, you know, say it better, because at each point this B sub T will be isomorphic to R, and you can make these choices in a sort of nice measurable way. So you end up, you know, proving quite easily that this B sub T that B is a tensor product, really, like here, okay? R tensor L infinity of X. So the normalizer will define, well, first of all, it will act the normalizer ergodically on the center. It has to act ergodically because otherwise M will not be a factor. But it may act, so you see what happens, even in general, not necessarily here, but here it's very obvious in this case. Namely that you have a groupoid, you have an acting groupoid rather than like in the irreducible case where you had an acting group, a normalizing group. Here you have a normalizing groupoid. So these are the points, say T, S, you know, of the, this is your space X. So transversally is X, it acts on this space X, okay? As a countable equivalence relation, okay, and so you have your, you know, your equivalence relation, which you can view as arrows, like, you know, the as a groupoid already there, but that's a very easy groupoid. However, in addition, here you have at each point a 2-1 factor, and there you have, you know, you may have isotropy, so you may at each point you may have a group, right, sort of acting, and you think it's very intuitively very obvious, okay, especially say, you know, for I mean, actually it's not good to the intuition is not good if you take X to be discrete, you know, just finitely many points, because then, you know, trivialized, the situation becomes trivial. So, okay. So it's a discrete measured groupoid, okay? Let's call it, so there is an object, what I'm trying to say behind, like we had before, we had a group in the irreducible case and an equivalence relation in the case, abelian case. And here I'm saying it's a combination of the two. You have the equivalence relation transversely on x0, which, by the way, this is the space of units of the groupoid. And above each point in the groupoid, you have an isotropy group. Okay, it's a, just a genuine group, genuine groupoid. Okay, above each point unit, you have a group in a groupoid. Those that have the source and the target, the same point. Okay, so it's G tilde, but I mean, I'm just not writing every time that it's the one that, you know, associated with B into M. Actually, we have that with the cocycle of this groupoid, so there is an abstract object with an action of G on B, okay, alpha B. A cocycle action, I'm sorry. And again, so there obviously, you know, conceptually this is a bit more complicated, but it's not a big deal. I'm trying to kind of, you know, convince you about that. So the isoclass of B into M is completely encoded in the cocycle conjugacy class of this groupoid action, okay? Okay, so it's the groupoid, but also the cocycle action. Huh? So, that's why it's a bit complicated. So in the factorial case, though, I mean, the nice thing there was that G becomes a group. You have just the X is just a single point, and you just have a group. Okay, this is your gamma at that point. You still have the. By the way, this is general. You don't need. Except that I should have not used the integral thing. This is good. You know, it's a field, a measurable field of. Okay. So, in the case R, n equals R, the discrete groupoid accounts for an amenable ergodic countable equivalence relation along the space of units. This is very trivial, that, you know, it's the equivalence relation is amenable, and also the isotropic groups at each point, they are also amenable. And acting outerly on also B at T, of course, this is just this, so, okay. Okay. So now let's get back with this kind of groupoid image in mind, notation. What happens in the case B abelian, G is just the countable relation. You have no isotropy, so it's just arrows that, you know, displace the points, okay, the equivalence relation. What happens with the alpha? There is no alpha, okay, in that case. Okay, it's in sort of intrinsic, it's just the equivalence relation, because I mean, R itself is also alpha, okay? For along this line, okay, alpha is just, you know, the equivalence relation. So giving the groupoid gives you also the alpha. So by the way, I want to point out that therefore, what Kohn-Feldman-Weiss theorem says is that there is just one amenable countable equivalence relation, just one amenable countable groupoid. I mean, groupoid with, you know, trivial isotropy. And it has vanishing cohomology, also, these two things. There is just one, so that's how you can reformulate Kohn-Feldman-Weiss. You see that it's much stronger than Ornstein-Weiss, because it says that there exists, I mean, you know, it's a beautiful theorem. It's just the Kohn-Feldman-Weiss says there is just one countable equivalence relation. It's like saying you have just one amenable group. But, I mean, from the orbit equivalence sense, a point of view, you know, that's it indeed true. So it also implies the Kornfeldmann vice that for each n, there is just one regular inclusion of type with B of type 1n. So if you take matrices over n by n matrices over an abelian, okay, that if that's your B, obviously this also says the uniqueness. So for each n, you have just one regular subalgebra. Okay, if B is a factor, the Gouverneur, this is just, you know, reminding you that that was. So what is it left? We have, I know, however, I wanted to point out that Ognanu trivially implies the case when Z of B, the center of B is atomic. Atomic means it's just finitely many because, you know, they have the same trace. The atoms, because of the ergodicity of the action, so they have to have the same trace. So that's also, you know, there exists a unique for each cardinality of, you know, of the center, of the dimension of the center. So there is, the case left is therefore when the center is diffuse, okay, non-atomic, so in other words, B is of this form, okay? So in other words, we are left with the problem of classifying co-cycle actions of groupoids, okay, onto this space, up to co-cycle conjugacy. So now, when V is trivial, so when there is no cohomology, okay, this was solved by the Sutherland Takesaki in 1985 by their theorem. So they proved that any two actions, alpha 1 and alpha 2, of the same amenable groupoid G on this algebra are cocycle conjugate, equivalent in any two regular inclusions like that with trivial cohomology, so with no twist, okay, are conjugate by an automorphism of R. Okay? So now, by this result, it follows that we are left with proving that any two cocycle for the cocycle action of a groupoid on this thing, of an amenable, discrete amenable groupoid. Why do you call it discrete? The discrete refers to the, it's like saying, the reason you say countable equivalence relation, or, you know, so it's discreteness, you know, in a sense, you know, this way. I mean, and at each point you have a discrete group, or a discrete countable group. So all discrete is, you know, to remind you of all this. And So you are left to proving the, you know, this vanishing cohomology thing. Well, this is not easy, actually. You know, it's a very subtle problem, and this is the last thing we have to prove, and that's what we will do. I guess maybe it's the proper moment to take a break until 05. So this is, I'll explain. We will take it from here after the break. Let's start then. As I said, this the vanishing cohomology of the two cohomology is a hard problem, and it's extremely interesting. I view this as a really, you know, very nice and also very beautiful problem. I'll kind of develop it beyond what we strictly need. So I'll go into more general considerations. So first of all, I wanted to remember in the hyperfinite 2-1 case, we know to untwist two cocycles for cocycle actions of amenable groups on the hyperfinite 2-1. That comes from Ognanu's theorem. Okay. we want to do this same thing for fields of 2-1 factor, measurable fields with groupoid actions, with groupoid co-cycle actions. So it's really a significantly more complicated problem, really significantly more complicated. And after all, why not look at that, you know, for completely arbitrary fields of 2-1 factors with co-cycle actions of arbitrary amenable groupoids on it, or perhaps not even amenable. After all, we saw that F2 untwists, so always there is no co-cycle there. Well, let's first talk some more about this problem in the 2-1 factor case, but where we no longer look at the actions, co-cycle actions, on the hyperfinite 2-1, but on arbitrary 2-1s. Okay, so what happens? There are two places where we can try to go beyond amenability. On the group side, okay, we saw that is also interesting because, you know, F2 has no cohomology. Or on the side of the 2-1 factor, okay? So, as it happens, it's true indeed that any countable amenable group, any frequent cycle gamma action on any 2-1 factor untwists, okay? So this is a result, well, I mean, so I have written this paper early in 2018. I considered it done a long time ago, and I kept saying that, you know, this is sort of implicit in my papers. Why is that so? It's because so I have done it for Z square, for this case, in 1989, and that was an important, moment because it triggered lots of. It was in a contrainte note, so I did only sketches of proofs. But it was an important, you know, article in the Compte Rendu. I think, you know, with sufficient indications for the proofs, it brought in the idea of taking the Poisson boundary for the graph of a subfactor in John's theory of subfactors, which developed into lots and lots of things. Anyway, so it was an important, you know, very important at that moment. So then things developed in subfactors. So I was using subfactor theory, you know, to prove this result. As you will see, the technique for proving this result is still subfactor theory, pure subfactor theory. And really, I think it's even, you know, nowadays, perhaps, you know, the most striking and unusual application of subfactor theory completely outside of subfactor theory, okay? So this vanishing of the cohomology. And I'll explain largely, you know, why subfactor theory, you know, was necessary, right? So things evolved, and what I needed, in fact, was gamma with polynomial growth. And more generally, gamma having a set of generators, finitely generated, in any case, for sure. And polynomial growth, or more generally, to have a set of finite generators for which the Poisson boundary is trivial. So there are no harmonic functions with respect to that. Then things developed in subfactor theory, and there is a remark where I explain in a paper of mine from 97, enveloping algebra, where I explain in details how you do obtain, for instance, classification of amenable subfactors with arbitrary amenable graph. So in a way, that also, you know, indicates how to do this. However, because I needed this result in some other things, I was thinking, you know, to sketch again the proof, and I looked back at all this history, and I realized that, you know, my God, at that time, it's true that those indications were sufficient, but, you know, that has been sort of lost. I mean, the younger people obviously will, you know, I mean, what am I saying, younger people? I discussed with, you know, my collaborator, you know, and friend, Stefan Vass, who told me, I don't understand anything of what you did. So I realized that, my God, I mean, you know, I better write this thing down, because it's, you know, you see, things evolved, and there are other people, and those people, I mean, you know, they are not the same of those who were at our conferences in subfactor theory at that time, where I could just say, well, but it's obvious, you know, you just do like that, and it's clear, so, which is basically what I said in my contradue note, and everybody was happy, and, you know, was accepted by the community as an actual proof. I looked back at that again, and I thought, well, this is nothing, you know, it just doesn't say that much. Anyway, so I wrote completely the proof of this result, and it's non-trivial, in fact, you know, it's not that short, in fact, when you give all the details. And of course, this immediately gives you this more general result, that you have that any action of a group like that, any cocycle action of a group like that, a free product of amenable groups, even with amalgamation of finite groups. So, you see, I gave the title of my talk is the ubiquitous hyperfinite one factor, and I was saying in the presentation that, you know, lots of what I will be doing depends on certain remarkable embeddings of the hyperfinite one factor in other factors. Well, this is a perfect example, but there were before, however, they were implicit, something I will emphasize hopefully tomorrow. Okay? So this whole strategy for proving this vanishing is the following. I mean, the idea is simple, and actually this is an idea I had very early, you know, like in 81, 82, except that I could not do it. So the idea I had was to build embeddings of the hyperfinite one that are gamma invariant, equivariant, I'm sorry, okay? Modulus aminor perturbation. So you perturb each alpha of G. Okay, you perturb each alpha of G by some unitary, if you want, but with that, you know, sacrifice, you getting into, you know, having to modifying it to another cocycle action, but which really leaves an invariant. Now, why you want to do that? Because then you want to use Ognanov's theorem and say I'm untwisting it on R and then claim I've untwisted it overall. However, if you think a little bit, it's not that, you know, obvious that solves the problem unless this subfactor R is kind of big in N. What you want is really this condition. So not only big in N, but big in N, you know, relative to this action in some sense. So it's this trivial relative commutant in the cross product that you want, okay? Why? Because you see, just having some things that normalize this new alpha prime G doesn't mean necessarily that you have the same group acting. You see, you may have introduced some, there may be some unitaries So some that are in N and normalize R, and which can give you a much bigger group, perhaps not even amenable, that's above this whole thing. Do you see what I mean? It's a co-cycle action. So, you know, every time you do this, okay, it gives you this add of something. Now, okay, and this guy can act outerly on your hyperfinite one factor. Okay? So, but that, with that condition, it won't. It will just keep. So, in particular, this would imply that your new cocycle, B prime, sits in R. So, when you are untwisted in R by Ocnano, you've untwisted it all. Okay? So, that's the idea. Okay? So, now, how you prove the existence of such an R, so an embedding, okay, so it comes to this, so it's this theorem, okay, let's put it here, okay, so unlike the vanishing of the cohomology, which we saw is not specific to amenable groups, okay, even Fn satisfies it, okay, this property of being able to build a hyperfinite, a big, large hyperfinite that's normalized by your group, modulo some perturbations, it's really actually with if and only if the group is amenable. I mean, the universal property. So by this I mean this theorem actually is true. Any cocycle action, let's change the notation because I want to separate it from the previous page for the action. Any cocycle action sigma of a countable amenable group gamma, I should have added 3, on an arbitrary 2-1 factor admits an inner perturbation that normalizes a hyperfinite subfactor with this property if and only if gamma is amenable. More precisely, if gamma is non-amenable, I mean, you have one implication. This, you know, if you have this, you have such a subfactor indeed. And if gamma is non-amenable, then there exists some action, more specifically, there is a free true action of gamma on the free group with infinitely many generators such that no inner perturbation of sigma can normalize a diffuse, even abelian, amenable subalgebra of N. Now, the proof of one, as I said, uses subfactor techniques, and you construct R, you see, this is the strategy. You construct this subfactor situation. Sorry. So you have gamma, we use now this notation, right? And say gamma is finitely generated, to start with. And then say by G1, GTG. And then you construct, you take this inclusion, let's call it M sigma. I should put also the generators, anyway. Where this factor M is this, it's N plus 1, this is N. Matrices over N, and this is actually this inclusion where you put X from here into this. Diagonal, and zero. So this is a subfactor situation with finite index N plus 1 square. And if the the graph, the, what's called the standard or the principal graph of this set factor is the Cayley graph of the group corresponding to this finite set of generators. And so the there is this tower of algebras and tunnel of algebras, which are specific to the theory of subfactor. And the R that we want to build in N, and that's invariant to this, is actually constructed through, you know, as an appropriate choice of a tunnel of subfactors. So it's like a sequence of subfactors with finite index, whose relative commutants are finite dimensional algebras, and R is obtained through an appropriate choice of this tunnel, so that when you take this relative commutants, well, first of all, it will give you a factor, because you know, the amenability plus actually also you know, there is a more in the case of trivial Poisson boundary like this one, it gives you automatically a subfactor. That's what means to have trivial Poisson boundary, that this is factorial, this limiting thing. Just by the fact that this kind of relative commutants, it's, how to say it, it's in your face that it it you can interpret that as a you know, as a subfactor of N that's left invariant by the action. It's really quite you know, amazing how, you know, just by using this the subfactor intuition, you know, just it's just you know, the all the point is to do this construction. But after that, you know, the fact that this is what provides you. So if you do this construction, so that, by the way, I forgot to say, you want to do it in a way that the relative commutants, so well, they automatically say, you know, generate a factor, but you want that to be kind of big in the sense of, you know, the model inclusion that you obtain as a relative, you know, from the relative commutants has exactly the same relative commutants as the initial thing. That is, you know, just translating this property here, okay? And that's, you know, through a certain technique of random choices, random embeddings of the hyperfinite to one, which is something I'm leaving for the last lecture, okay? This kind of embedding, techniques for embedding hyperfinite to one. But it's modulo that, you know, it's really taking you by the hand through subfactor techniques, so this subfactor intuition. Okay, the other thing, yeah, so basically for this second part, if you take here the Bernoulli gamma action on the generators, then, you know, what I did with Taka, proving that, you know, you have no diffuse amenable subalgebra of the hyperfinite factors. Well, any amenable has the normalizer, must be amenable. So that's what you use for the converse. So indeed, this is a property that's specific to amenability. Okay, so now with this in hand, this is what we could prove for this kind of fields, of measurable fields. With this is a newer paper at the end of the summer last year. Was really a follow-up of discussions we had, Dimash Liartenko, Stefan Vas, and myself at IPAM during the program last spring at IPAM. So we proved that if G is a discrete measured groupoid with units, say, X, and you take a measurable field of 2-1 factors over this X, and you assume that G is amenable, and that you have, and then you take a free cocycle action of this groupoid on this measurable field of one factors. Then the cocycle V is co-boundary. So I write it, you know, kind of roughly. It's obviously, you know, this is a more complicated object, you know, the groupoid fields of one factors, etc. So it's clear that, you know, we kind of use the our, you know, we leave it like that. I'm not even giving, you know, even it would have taken me a lot of time just to explain very carefully and rigorously what a group, such a discrete measure groupoid is. And I avoided that, okay? So, well, with this in hand, of course, it means that we proved our classification of regular subalgebras, right? So let's point that out. So with this, we do have the two regular for Neumann subalgebras in particular, satisfying this R conjugate by an automorphism of R if and only if they are of the same type and they have isomorphic associated discrete measured groupoids. So this is what was missing after Sutherland Takesaki, okay? This vanishing cohomology. Remember, this was the missing piece. So we have that, therefore we have all this classification. It's okay. Now, there is a second part to our theorem which is not evident, okay, I would say. So we were also able to prove that any such regular subalgebra of R contains a Cartan subalgebra, and that if you take two copies of Cartan in B, okay, then there exists an automorphism of R that leaves B invariant and takes A1 onto A2, which is kind of, you know, I would say, well, for sure it was not known, but also, we were kind of pleased and surprised to get also this as a, like a gift, you know, like a bonus. Okay, so about the proof. The proof uses the vanishing of the two cohomology for cocycle actions of amenable groups on 2-1 factors, so the thing I stated before. Of course, you kind of use, there is nothing you can do. You also need to know that, you know, in this direction things vanish. So Kornfeldmann-Weiss enters in this also, okay? No, but this part refers to this. So, I mean, it's like so which we apply to the isotropy, of course not constant by vice, but this. It's a bit misleading how I formulate it, which we apply to the isotropy groups of the amenable groupoid. I mean, we apply the whole thing to extend to the entire G. The thing is, I mean, of course, you see, I mean, intuitively, what do? You vanish it this way, and you vanish it at each point, okay? You cancel it. But of course, this is a measurable choice. You have a big problem there, okay? So it's not like you cancel the cohomology at each point and that's that, right? Along this line, it's fine, because of course, with Kornfeldmann-Weiss, you do it measurably. But with doing it at each point, certainly, you know, it's not working. So to extend indeed to the entire G, we have to make equivariant choices of the two cocycle vanishing for the isotropy groups. Okay, where the equivariance, of course, will have to be with respect to the isomorphism, you know, from gamma T to gamma S given by the conjugation with an element in G with this arrows, right? And this you have to do, okay, in a sort of measurable way. Okay, so obviously, at least I convinced you that there is a problem there and that it's probably not simple to resolve. So actually the proof of this thing depends on two key points, okay? The first one is a technical result showing that such an equivalent choice does exist provided that the two co-cycle vanishing for each group, okay, can be done in an approximately unique way. Well, by the way, if the vanishing of the two cohomology is unique, okay, somehow, you know, by a miracle, like, you know, as I will show you later, for instance, if the groups are finite, then it is unique in some sense, okay? Okay, well, it's actually, luckily, it's sufficient to do it approximately unique, okay? The fact that the two co-cycle untwist in an approximately unique way amounts to, let's translate that into some sort of, you know, this is kind of, I purposely did it, you know, in a vague manner, but this is what it really means, okay? Untwisting in an approximately unique way really amounts to the fact that, so choosing various untwisting of your various two co-cycles, you know, so untwisting a two co-cycle, you remember, it's a derivative of a one co-cycle. And saying that you have a unique such solution is like saying that you have that any one co-cycle, any two of those will differ by a one co-cycle. You see that right away, okay? That's general, you know, cohomology theory. And so if you can prove that one co-cycle vanishes, I mean, it's a co-boundary, then you prove your uniqueness. Well, actually, you have to do that approximately, so that amounts to the fact that any one co-cycle is approximately co-boundary. Now that, we came to a problem which is clearly formulated and which we will discuss, okay? And that's the second point. The second point is to prove that such approximate vanishing one. So first point is to reduce it to that, and second point, key point, is to prove that any approximate vanishing one cocycle for an arbitrary action of an amenable group, any one cocycle is approximately vanishing. Okay? So that, now that's for gamma t, for n sub t. So it's a cocycle on a 2-1 factor. This is a down to earth, you know, no longer all these, you know, terrible complications with groupoids and with fields of Hodges. It's a clear problem. So this is the problem. Approximate vanishing one cohomology question. Okay, first of all, what's the definition? One cocycle, first of all, for an action is a map W from gamma to the unitaries of n. This is a 2-1 factor, n here, such that you have this. Okay? The cocycle W is co-boundary if there exists a unitary in n such that WG is this 4. You can see immediately that this checks. And this is, you know, so it comes from a 0. It's the derivative of, you know, so previous, I mean, will be like the 0, I mean, just taking one element. And it is approximate co-boundary if there exists a sequence of unitaries such that WG is approximately so. Okay, pretty self-explanatory, actually, what approximate vanishing should be. That, by the way, please notice that it's absolutely the same as saying that W is co-boundary as a one co-cycle for the ultra power of the action on the ultra power of n. Now that's a moment where we should say what the ultra power, ultra product are. Let's see. Yeah. So it's something we did not really define. when I gave the list of operations, constructions of factors. So if Mn is a sequence of finite factors, so they can be 2-1 factors or n some k by k matrices, each one of them. And I also want, because I want to get some interesting things, I will take, say, these are matrix algebras, the dimensions to go to infinity. So I don't want to take constantly just 2 by 2 matrices, okay? And I take also omega, a ultra filter, on n, that's non-trivial. So that means it's like thinking omega is in here, right? It's a point in the Stone-Check compartification, and which is not on the, you know, the n part. It's really a point at infinity. Okay. How do you call this non-principal, no, free ultra filter, or non-principal? Okay, and then I take the algebra n infinity, not n infinity, the direct sum of n by n matrices. Okay, so let's call this M. And on this I'm taking. So by the way, if all M n are equal to n for all n, this is the same, this becomes little n infinity of the bounded sequences with values in n, okay? So these are bounded sequences, but with the entries being in Mn, Xn is in Mn, okay? And on this, I take this trace, this functional, the omega of a sequence. Remember, this is bounded in uniform norm. It's this. So I take the trace on Mn. Here it's kind of convenient to use the notation of the algebra. Okay, and I'm taking a Banach limit, a limit over omega of this. Okay, so this is by definition this. That's the tau omega. What is the meaning of that? This is a sequence that's bounded, okay? Say in this case, it's like it's in L infinity of n. It's a bounded sequence of scalars, and you apply omega to it, okay? So you evaluate it at omega. It's a function in this, in little L infinity of this, and you, this is, you know how you, this space, this, okay, it's the one that gives you L infinity of n to be the continuous of on omega, right? And it's, okay, so it's a trace on M, and what you do is you take your ultra power over omega, along omega, ultra product, I'm sorry, omega ultra product of Mn is this M, the quotient by the ideal of this trace. The ideal of the trace given any trace on a sister algebra, this is a sister algebra, M is a sister algebra, and you have a trace. So this is the set of all, let's call them X. Okay, by polarization, you see that this is a vector space, and it's actually an ideal, a two-sided ideal in M and it's star, it's everything, it's closed. So you this in C-star theory, C-star algebra theory, this will be a C-star algebra. And moreover, it obviously has a trace. Tau omega implements a trace, which after you have done all this, it's faithful. Faithful. Trace state. That's faithful. And here is one of the nicest, you know, applications of the that characterization of abstract characterization of a 2-1 factor that we gave. The point is that the unit ball, so the unit ball of this guy, okay, is complete in the norm 2, in this norm 2 given by this one on the quotient. So it's a 2-1 factor. So, well, it's a finite from Neumann algebra, but you see, immediately, this is a factor. I mean, the center is trivial, and this, so it's this, obviously, because of this condition, you know, the dimensions of Mn tending to infinity will easily show you that it is diffuse, so it's a 2-1 factor. It's an enormous 2-1 factor. It's not separable, but it's, you know, very useful for analysis, you know, arguments and formalism for Neumann algebra in 2-1 factor theory. It's very important because of that. So not to study by itself, although logicians may differ in opinion on that. In any case, it's more, we use it as a tool in 2-1 factor theory. So is you see clearly, for instance here, you see how beautifully, obviously when you have an action, so you, if all of them are the same, you call this n omega to the power omega, okay? So this is n omega if all, if mn equals n for all n, okay? So obviously, you know, applying point by point, entry by entry gives you an action sigma omega on n omega when you have an action. And if it's a cocycle, it's a cocycle action. Then one cocycle, etc. Okay? So this is what we were able to prove. So if gamma is amenable, then indeed, for any free action of an amenable group of the group gamma on a 2-1 factor, or rather, so let's just take 1 and 4. So if gamma is amenable, then indeed any one cocycle W for any gamma action on a 2-1 factor is approximately co-boundary. Or if you prefer, it's a really a true co-boundary as an action on n omega, as a cocycle for sigma omega. Actually, it's an if and only if. It's a characterization of amenability, so you also have, it's an if and only if thing. And the key point here for this equivalence is this point 2, that in fact, these are also equivalent to the fact that for any free action of gamma, the fixed point algebra of sigma omega on n omega is a subfactor with trivial relative commutant in n omega, okay? And I would say it's unexpected. I mean, well, anyway, so let me show you before the end of today's class the proof of this, because that's nice. And anyway, we kind of missed to do too many proofs except for this sketch of proof for Ognano, etc. But otherwise, we didn't do today too much proof, so let's do a proof. Actually, I think, unfortunately, the first part is in details here. The second part, I'll have to do it at the blackboard because I didn't have time to put it on the page. Okay. Although I just needed to paste it from a place, but I was afraid to do some to corrupt again the file, like it happened to me yesterday. It was too rushed, and I didn't want to do it in the last moment, you know, to have problems with the processing the file. So the proof of the approximate one cohomology. So let me go back to the what I told you about this result of Jones from his 1980 paper, his thesis. I told you that he showed that not only any two action of a finite group on the hyperfinite one are conjugate. I mean, that by itself already shows that in that case you have the vanishing of any one cocycle for the action, for the gamma action. But that part actually is true for any action on any of the finite group on any 2-1 factor. So he proved, in other words, that if any one cocycle for a free action, sigma of a finite group gamma on a two on an arbitrary 2-1 factor is compound. So his proof actually only uses the fixed point algebra of any such action is an irreducible subfinite. Okay, that's what you use. So let me show you the proof. So let sigma twist. So I'm taking a cocycle W. I forgot to take it. So let's W be a one cocycle. Sigma is my action. Sigma is my action. Yes, here it is. And W is my one cocycle. I take it normalized. W of E is equal to one. Okay, so I construct this action, sigma tilde, to be simply on 2x2 matrices. So this is, by the way, make a parenthesis, this is pretty famous. And this is the so-called Kohn's 2x2 matrix trick. Okay, that's how he untwisted cocycle in a, you know, it's a pretty, you know, famous trick, very nice, very sleek trick. So I'm taking sigma tilde to be the, well, just this is the plane amplification of sigma by 2x2 matrices. Okay, so you amplify by 2x2 matrices, right? You just apply sigma g to the entries. Okay, so and so I'm taking the matrix units that come with these 2x2 matrices, Eij, and I'm now taking this cocycle, I mean, this function Wg twiddle, which is E11 plus Wg. So here I take 1 and here Wg, direct sum of the trivial cocycle, 1 cocycle, and the cocycle Wg. Okay? Okay, I claim that this is a 1 cocycle for sigma tilde, and I let you check that it's a trivial. Okay, so this is, then I can construct the sigma g prime, which is the perturbation of sigma tilde with this one cocycle. This will be an action, because this is a one cocycle. Okay, so this is a true action. Okay, so it's fixed point algebra is a trivial a subfactor with trivial relative commutant. Well, that's a general fact, which is was kind of well known, but certainly emphasized by Jones. So Jones emphasized quite a bit the fact, but Sutherland, I don't remember who in fact really did this, probably simultaneously, independently. Sutherland, Jones made lots of observations. This is really trivial. Any free action of any finite group on any 2-1 factor, the fixed point algebra is a 2-1 factor which is irreducible. Okay? Or the fact that you have so the existence of a unitary element in N that satisfies this, it's trivially equivalent, and that is another exercise, to saying that these two projections, E11 and E22, which of course are in the fixed point, right? This and also sigma, the initial sigma leaves E11 and E22 fixed. So altogether, this sigma prime will leave these guys fixed.
they are in Q, which is a 2-1 factor. These have trace equal to 1/2, each one of them. So they are conjugate. And by what I'm claiming, you know, it has to be, that is the same as giving you, you know, this amplicity. This is nice. I mean, you know, so this is Kohn's trick, okay? And, okay, so the above shows that if we can show that this was written in the last moment. So the above shows that this, what we just showed was that if we can show this thing, This. So if we can show that any free action, its ultra power has a fixed point, a subfactor with trivial relative count. If we can show this, then we have 4. So 2 implies 4. Next, it's the proof. I mean, I gave you the proof. Whenever, because, of course, that's because any, I mean, the omegaification, okay, of sigma is, you know, behaves well with respect to the omega. So the, it's the twist, the, it's this that we have to, it's this sigma triple prime that we take, you know. But this is also an action, and it's also an ultra power. So if we offer an amenable group, so if that is true for any of that, it will be true for this, and therefore, you know, you have in that 2 implies 4, right? That's what I was saying here, but I... So the above shows that 2 implies 4. Let us show that 1 implies 2. So that means this 1, the, if gamma is amenable, then the fixed point are. So I mean, this is the crux of the matter. After all, we are interested in 2 implies 4. Forget about the other implication. We want to prove that gamma is implies this, right? This is our, I mean, because this is what solves the problem with the vanishing of the 2 cohomology, you remember? So, I mean, it's fun to have these equivalences, but it's 1 implies 4 that we need. So we already have 2 implies 4, let's prove 1 implies 2. So this also, it uses quite a bit, you know, this kind of random embeddings of the hyperfinite 2-1, but in a hidden way, okay? So this is what you do. So if you have this action of a countable group on a 2-1 factor, so this is like a black box here that we will be using, like we use the local quantization lemma, and it's in that family of results, okay? As I say, you know, it actually uses, you know, random kind of embeddings of the hyperfinite 2-1 in 2-1 factors. So with that, you can prove this thing that you will always have in an omega unitaries with the property that, I mean, after you can put this thing, you can switch n, actually any kind of separable subalgebra in n, in a way that so that, you know, sigma g omega operates on this as the free shift. So this, you can make them freely independent, are mutually free independent, okay? Meaning that the traces of any year, so it's like having that these algebras generate the free products, they generate like this. And, okay, so a copy of that with, by the way, you know, I made my choices, okay? This is not quite n, it's something isomorphic to n, it's u and u star. By the way we made our choices, sigma g acts on it by shifting the coordinates, right? So, it means that basically I have a very concrete out of a completely arbitrary gamma action in an omega. I have some piece on which sigma acts in a very concrete manner. Okay? So the thing is that on this free Bernoulli action, you can very easily construct things that are approximately fixed by sigma omega, by the action. How? This is very easy. You just take, you take Fellner sets and you sum up, okay, so you take, say, a B, actually this is U and U star, right? But, okay, so you take here a semicircular. You can take any kind of element, but let's take it semicircular, and then you take sigma g omega of B, and you sum this up over a Fellner set. And you divide by this, by the size of the Fellner set, well, actually, to 1 over 2. So this way, you see, these are, in any case, with respect to the L2 norm, they are mutually orthogonal. So this gives you an element that has norm 2 equal to 1. But the thing is that because of the entries being freely independent, any kind of things that you take in little L infinity of, you know, things that are freely independent, in little L2, I'm sorry, of things that are freely independent, the norm 2 is essentially the norm infinity. You know, this is one of the, you know, Voiculescu's absolutely initial observations in free probability. And so this actually is a substantial, you know, operator. It's not like it has a bad shape. Actually, it has a semicircular shape itself. It's a beautiful semicircular system with of norm 1, okay? And obviously, because of my construction, it's almost independent to sigma g because of the Fellnerness of k. When you shift it by sigma g, it almost stays the same, okay? So you constructed things which are almost invariant and, you know, are kind of diffuse. They generate, obviously, subspace. You prove that you have, you know, far at infinity, even in a free manner, independent manner, with everything you want, things that are almost invariant. So that tells you that this fixed point algebra, the fixed point, has things, okay, that, you know, a huge algebra, first of all, diffuse, okay? It's far from being strongly ergodic, your action on this, okay? And anything, for instance, these guys, the way we constructed it, they are freely independent with anything you wanted in N, you know, that was my choice of U. So, but with things that are free independent of something, you can kill those elements by averaging with things in this fixed point algebra. So I proved that, you know, given any finite set of elements, you can. So what this says is that this, the fixed point algebra, okay, can kill anything in N. You can find things in the fixed point that can kill by averaging anything. So that's what's saying that the fixed point algebra is trivial relative count. Incidentally, you only need it to prove that it's a factor, but that's, you know, very difficult because you cannot put your hands on the algebra. So you try to kill anything, therefore, you know, so that's exactly what you need. So that's that. I guess this we missed to get to this. So what I wanted to prove, because it comes nicely into this whole discussion, I would rather it end, so straight for me. Thank you. So it's because it's so related with the two vanishing of the two cohomology, there is this really very simple observation. It looks kind of fancy, lots of notations here. I wanted to emphasize that there is a way to reformulate Kohn's embedding problem, okay, almost in its full generality, not quite, through as a vanishing two cohomology problem. And it's the right place, of course, to say that. So here is how we do it. So let me state that we have not much room here, but Kohn's embedding conjecture, let me put it that way, so C stands for that, says that any 2-1 factor, did I call it, let's call it, yeah, 2-1 factor separable, so countably generated, there exists an embedding of it into R omega, or what's equivalent into the ultra power, ultra product of n by n matrices. Okay, so this, it's trivial to see that the two are equivalent. Here is the sequence of trivial observation. First of all, so R, of course, embeds in R omega, any m embeds into m in its ultra power as constant sequences. If you take the commutant of R in R omega, this gives you a huge 2-1 factor, in fact, huge enough that its commutant in R omega is back to R. So you have this bicommutant result, which is kind of easy to prove. Another simple observation is that any automorphism of R, we should have made this long time ago, there exists a unitary in the normalizer of R in R omega that implements it. This is trivial because you have, obviously, for n by n matrices, 2 to the n, so let's think of R as a limit of 2 to the n by 2 to the n. On any automorphism acting on some algebra, okay, if you have in the subalgebra take any n by n matrices in any factor and take an automorphism, then that automorphism restricted to that subalgebra, finite dimensional subalgebra, is implemented by a unitary. It's a trivial exercise, by the way. That's like one of the first things, you know, I remember doing, you know, when I started, you know, in this subject. I mean, you know, when I was 20 or 21, well, you know, these were like the basic exercises I've been given, okay? So, for instance, this one, okay? And so, with that, you take the sequence of, for each bigger and bigger algebra, and you get, you know, therefore, you know, you have this approximate innerness of the automorphism of the automorphism of R. So, and also, if you have another one that implements the same thing, okay, obviously they will differ by perturbation by a unitary in the commutant of R, right? So you have it unique. You theta up to this choice of multiplying with some unitary from the left or from the right. All this tells you what? Okay, it tells you that this theta goes to R u of theta, okay, restricted to R omega, okay, gives you a map, okay, from the automorphism of R to the automorphism of R omega, okay, and it needs just a little bit. By the way, that automatically you can, it will also implement on R wedge R omega, because you have, it normalizes R, it normalizes R omega. So, okay, and you can prove that it's in fact, actually that's the way I should have said it first. Okay, so it implements because it normalizes, okay, this normalizes, U theta normalizes R. So it normalizes also R lower omega, the commutant, or r prime intersected r omega. Okay? And I'm claiming that this initial theta is outer dependent only if this theta sub omega is outer on this 2-1 factor. It's an easy exercise. Okay? And if and only if this twiddle theta omega, which you also have it on this, is outer. So there is this. Any free action, therefore, gives rise to a free cocycle action, sigma twiddle omega of gamma on this by just taking other of sigma. Okay? So the corresponding two cocycle, by the way, takes values here, is this thing. These are trivial observations. So what did we come to? So it means, by the way, I make another trivial observation. Any two copies, we mentioned that, you know, any two copies of R in an ultra power, any ultra power, are unitary conjugate. So it means that if I take any free action of a countable group gamma on the hyperfinite one, this guy, this cross product, 2-1 factor, in particular your L of gamma, okay, will embed, okay, into the, I call it CAE because that's for cons approximate embedding. I usually like to put, people in general put just C, cons embedding. It's true that cons embedding automatically it's an approximate. So you can read that way. It's an actual embedding in R omega. Okay, if and only if this two cocycle vanishes. Of course, because, you know, if you, of course, if you can untwist the cocycle, it means you have the embedding, and vice versa. Okay, if you have the embedding, then you put your R there, right? You move it with the unitary to the position of constant sequences. Then his normalizer, the canonical unitaries, are in this. It's one of those. It means they come. You remember, it's a unique choice up to the cosine. So it means you, it's like, it means you untwisted that cosine. So it implies conversely that you untwisted the cosine. So it's, you have this if and only. Okay, I wanted to. So it's a nice, cute, you know, really almost trivial. And by the way, I should point out that it's an observation I made, I think, in 2001 or 1999, 2000, 2001, something like that, at the crossover, that period. And until then, I was absolutely convinced that Kant's embedding has an affirmative value. Now, after this, I changed 180 degrees, and I said, it's impossible. This cannot possibly happen. Okay, but then, you know, time passed, and I thought, well, you know, actually, so since then, you know, more and more frequently, I'm passing through being convinced it cannot to convince it can. So, right now I'm in a period where I rather believe it can, but, okay, stop here.